have a seat. This morning, we're going to be in Romans chapter 15. Romans 15, it's printed up in your Sunday morning news there in your bulletin. It's also on the screens. And if you are using the YouVersion Bible app, there's some special notes that are inserted in the scripture, kind of a bonus content for you if you're using that. You can also access that later on Bible.com if you would like. So Romans chapter 15. We're going to hit the first few verses there. Recently, I discovered something, and I'm sure you have too at some point. If you have Wi-Fi in your house, anybody have Wi-Fi? Probably, yes. This is 2017. You may have discovered dead spots in your house where the signal's not so great, where you don't get the full signal, you don't get full access or something, it's slow, whether it's the distance from the router or there's something in the wall that's blocking the signal or there's some issue that's going on. Well, I recently discovered what I perceive to be a dead spot. Some years ago when I originally had, you know, a bunch of knee problems, we got this elliptical machine and it kind of got shoved in the garage, and as I've been doing it more, doing it again as I was supposed to, I go out there and I put my iPad, I kind of strap it with bungee cords to a bunch of tubs that are set up in the garage, so you can imagine what that looks like. But I've got that there and it connects to the Wi-Fi and I watch something, it makes it go faster, it doesn't seem as long when I'm on the thing. But then in the middle of, like this morning, it happened this morning three or four times, I was watching something on YouTube. I was watching a thing about a church on YouTube. I want you to think I'm holier than I am, but that just happened to be what it was this morning. I was watching that thing, and it kept cutting out, in and out. And I was like, I mean, the router from where I was in the garage was only like 20 feet. And this has happened before, and I've moved the router. I've moved it high. I've moved it to the side. I've moved it over there. I've moved where I set the device in the garage, and the connection still drops every single time, and I can't figure it out. Well, then I ended up doing a little more research on the thing and discovered that it wasn't the router that was the problem. It was my device. My device was losing connection. The router was sending out the signal, was sending out the Wi-Fi wave, sending it out there, but my device wasn't connecting. My device was the problem. So I had to reconnect. I had to take the time in the moment, go to the settings, and reconnect myself to the signal. Now, a lot of times, as we're going to see today in Romans chapter 15, spiritually speaking, that happens to a lot of us. God sends out his signal. God sends out his potential connection, and we get disconnected from it ourselves. Whether it be something's in the way or there's some problem, or maybe we just turn ourselves on airplane mode and we block the signal. Whatever the reason, we are missing out on the connection that God desires us to have. And here in Romans chapter 15, the Apostle Paul wrote this letter to a bunch of Christians living in Rome. It was a very diverse church, and he was writing to them about a whole myriad of issues. And we get to Romans chapter 15, and he addresses something very interesting. We started a series a couple weeks ago exploring this idea of what it means to interact with one another. We looked at how Jesus introduced us to the idea of loving one another and what that looks like. Well, then we also saw last week how Paul takes the idea that Jesus introduced loving one another, and Paul begins to describe what loving one another looks like. And he does it several dozen times throughout the New Testament, and we're just going to look through a few of those over these next few weeks. Last week we saw how to encourage one another, and this week we're going to have another one of those one another passages here. And this section of Romans chapter 15 is a build up as Paul gets ready to drop that one another phrase on us. So I want you to start in Romans chapter 15, verse 1. Paul writes, "And we who are strong owe a debt to endure the weaknesses of those who are not strong, and not to please ourselves." Now let's look at that verse for a second. He says, we who are strong, we who are powerful. He's talking spiritually speaking. He's saying we who have known Jesus for some time having known Jesus for some time, we should be growing in our relationship with Jesus. And if we have, then we are powerful. We are spiritually strong. And we ought to, he says there, endure the weaknesses. Or another way to say it is the limited capacity of those who are not strong. And the way we do that, he says it at the end of the verse, is to not please ourselves, is to not make our own preferences and our own desires the sole purpose of our outlook. It's to be selfless, not selfish. It's to not engage what we would maybe desire something to look like for the sake of somebody who is weaker so they can grow in Christ. You know, in their context, it was a whole bunch of cultural issues. We think of our culture as diverse here. I mean, their culture there was incredibly diverse. They had people of all kinds of backgrounds, all kinds of social classes that outside of church would never have associated with each other, would have hated each other, had great disdain for each other. But then they come to this church and they're supposed to get along, love each other, welcome one another, encourage one another, and build each other up. And Paul says, so to do that, you need to set aside the junk. You need to set aside the differences, not worry about pleasing yourself and making yourself happy. That's not the issue. The issue is Jesus and making that person closer to Jesus than they are now. And if that means I don't get what I want about a certain thing or issue or problem or whatever, then fine. If it means that person grows closer to Christ. And culture has changed in their particular area, in our particular area. It means a whole bunch of different things. You know, we realize this in our own homes, but a lot of times we have trouble with it in church. Whether it be the way we dress or the songs we sing or the service times or the preaching style or having a pulpit or not having a pulpit or who is somebody sitting in my pew or whatever it might be, we might have an issue with one of those things and we might have a problem and not be able to worship that day because one of those things is out of whack and having a problem. And Paul's saying, you should not be worried about making yourself happy. That's not it. You should be worried about making the other person comfortable so they can worship Jesus. The issue is them coming to know Jesus, not about where I'm at and what I can do and what I want and me and mine and me and whatever. Because if you are growing in Christ, as he says there, if you are strong, then it's not about you. It's not about me. He actually describes this in 1 Corinthians chapter 1. He had a whole faction in the church in 1 Corinthians chapter 1 where people were arguing about what was their favorite preacher. I like this guy and I like that guy. And Paul says it doesn't matter. What matters is they're talking about Jesus. You can say the same about music. It doesn't matter as long as you're singing about Jesus. It doesn't matter what kind of clothes you're wearing as long as you're talking about Jesus. It doesn't matter what you smell like as long as you're talking about Jesus. Jesus is the point. Jesus is the issue. And Paul's really trying to drive that at these Romans. He says, if you're strong, now look at that phrasing. You owe a debt to endure the weaknesses. He doesn't say change the weaknesses. That might come later. He says endure the weaknesses for the moment so that those who are not strong may become stronger. And like I said, we do this sometimes in our families. I mean, we as parents, if your child is sick, you are more than willing to surrender your own rights, your own schedule, your own comfort for their benefit to make sure they are okay and they get stronger and they grow. You're willing to forego all of your stuff just so that they're taken care of. And Paul says that's the same thing with believers. If there's someone who is not quite as strong and needs to grow, forego your own comfort, forego your own schedule and your own quote-unquote rights so that they can grow in Christ. Look at verse 2. Paul writes, let each of us please his neighbor for the building up for his good. For Christ also did not please himself, but just as it has been written, the insults of those insulting you fell on me. Now, I love the way verse 2 is there and the word Paul uses as he goes through that. Let each of us please his neighbor for the building up, for the strengthening. The literal phrasing of that word in the original language is increasing the potential of somebody else. Let us each please his neighbor for his potential to be increased, so that they can grow more in Christ and have a better potential outcome in what God wants them to do. Let us please his neighbor, because he says there, Jesus did the same thing. Jesus did not please himself. Jesus gave up his schedule. Jesus gave up his comfort. Jesus gave up his rights as the creator of the world to die, as that prophecy there from Psalm 69 he quotes. Jesus died so that we might know God, so that we might have eternal life. Jesus did not please himself so that he could suffer in our place. And so if we as Christians are to follow the example of Jesus, we ought to be doing the same thing. We ought to not be concerned about me and mine, and ought to be concerned about the one who needs to grow in Christ further along. We need to be helping them, encouraging them, as we spoke about last week. The insults of those insulting you fell on me. The sins being committed fell on me. And Jesus paid for those. Look at verse 4. For as much as was written before, it was written for our instruction, so that with the perseverance and with the encouragement of the scriptures, we might have hope. So with as much as was written before, he's talking about everything that was written for Scripture. All that was written in Scripture was written for our instruction, for our benefit, so we could grow. And he says there, within the pages of Scripture is great perseverance, is great encouragement, and it gives us hope. Within Scripture, within God's Word, we can gain perseverance and encouragement. It is infused with it. And if we spend time investing in it, not only will we be growing in Christ because of the great hope he says we have there, we will gain perseverance through the trials and the tribulations of this world, and we will gain encouragement so that we don't get too down and discouraged from what is going on around us. So the closer we grow to Jesus, the closer, or the more encouragement and perseverance we gain, because our hope has been increased. Verse 5, there's a reason that Scripture has perseverance and encouragement, and we have it in verse 5. He says, and the persevering and encouraging God may give to you all the same thoughts in one another according to Christ Jesus, so that with one mind, in one mouth, you might praise the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, this is the point of everything he said so far. Is the reason we're supposed to not please ourselves but please others so they can grow in Christ is so that with one mind and one mouth we might praise Jesus. With one thought, that he would put one thought in the mind of all of us, and that would be to bring praise to Jesus. Because it is about Jesus. Just as we sang, victory in Jesus. Not victory in Josh. That's not what it is. It's victory in Jesus. And if we are pursuing him, if we are anticipating where he wants us to go, and we're following after him, and we're getting in sync with his word, then we will be in sync with each other. You see, if I am growing in Christ and my wife, Katie, is growing in Christ, then we will be growing closer to Christ together. And by us getting in sync to Christ, we will be in sync to each other. This comes to mind. I had this thought the other day as we do a lot in the office, and we need to know, you know, what's going on in the calendar and with our family, all this going on. And I don't know about y'all, but on my phone, I've got a bunch of different calendars. We've got a calendar for the staff in the office. We've got a calendar. You can see, you can't really see them because it's real tiny, but I got a bunch of calendars on there. We got a calendar for the staff. We have a public calendar for the church. I've got a personal calendar. We've got a family calendar. We've got calendar items from other members of the family. And it's all there, and I can look at it, and I can see each of those things on the calendar that as Josh might update something for DNow this weekend, and it would sync up to the cloud, and that would sync up to my phone, and I can see it. Or if Katie puts something on the calendar for our family, and her phone syncs up, and then my phone syncs up, and I can see it. So we're synced up to the cloud, and we're synced up to each other. But if I put my phone on airplane mode, and I just access what I've got, I can do all the updates I want, but nobody else is going to see them. They can do all the updates they want, and they can be all synced up to each other, and they can be synced up to the cloud, but if I'm on airplane mode, I'm synced up to nobody. And I'm operating out there on an island of maybe calendar bliss and ignoring everybody else and what's going on and just doing my own thing, but in doing that, missing out on what everybody's got and missing out on where everybody is and potentially where I need to be if I'm not observing the calendar. And that's a very simple picture of us spiritually. That if we're not syncing up to God, we're not syncing up to each other. It's just not going to happen. We're not going to have that one thought that he says in verse 5 he plants in us. We're not going to have the one mind and the one mouth that he desires us to have. We're going to have our own, not the one he wants to implant in all of us. We're not going to be praising him in the same way he wants all of us to praise him. We're going to be doing what we want to do in our own time, in our own thing, according to our own agenda and not his. We need to be synced up to him, and then we'll be synced up to each other. Because if we're not synced up to him, we will not be synced up to each other. If there are syncing problems, we must check our connection. We must check our connection. You see, too often we try to correct what we see in others as deficiencies. We may have a connection problem, a disconnect somewhere with each other, and we immediately assume there's a problem with the other person. They're way out of whack, and they've got a problem with whatever they got going on today. They got a problem with Jesus. They got a problem with this, that, and the other thing. All the while, spiritually, we're on airplane mode, and we're disconnected from God ourselves. And we're too busy trying to correct the deficiencies in them to miss the fact that we're disconnected from Jesus ourselves. See, once we get connected and we have that one thought and that one mind and that one mouth of praising God, we're able to do what Paul writes in verse 7. He says, "Therefore, welcome one another, just as also Christ welcomed you into God's glory." He says, welcome one another. No matter where you are spiritually, no matter what that other person's got going on in their past or even got going on in their life right now or what is happening with them, he says, welcome one another. Welcome one another. There's no asterisk there with a little subpoint or a little footnote saying, except in this case, or if that person's got this problem, or if that person's dealing with this, or if that makes you move, or if that makes you do this, that, or the other thing. No, it just says, welcome one another. Anybody, everybody, welcome one another. Because Christ welcomed you. Christ, perfect Jesus, perfect God, welcomed me in my sinful state. So how much easier then should it be for me to welcome one another? Welcome one another. And when we have those sinking problems and we have difficulty connecting and welcoming one another and we see there is some disunity or there is some link-up problem with whatever we got going on. Maybe it's you and your spouse or you and your kids or you and a friend or you and somebody. Maybe it's you and somebody in this room and you have that spot in your peripheral vision intentionally blocked out because you don't want to see them. Whatever the sync-up problem is, this welcoming concept that Paul introduces here needs to be an innate part of our lives. It needs to be built in. It needs to be a part of who we are. You see, because, as that says, you see on the screen, with the capacity of grace that Jesus welcomed you, you are to welcome others. Jesus welcomed you with infinite grace, never-ending grace. And so with that same grace, we ought to be welcoming to anybody and everybody around us without exception. Without exception. We have to welcome them and bring them in using the same concept that he said in verse 1, enduring their weaknesses. Not saying, I will only welcome you, I will only allow you in my general vicinity, in my Sunday school class, on my pew, in my church. I will only allow you if you fix that weakness, if you fix that one there. I'm not going to endure that weakness. That is one weakness too far. I'm not going to go that route. You got to fix that before you can come over here and deal with this, before I will welcome you in, before I will change any of what I'm going on. You got to fix you. But that's not the way Jesus operates. Jesus loves you too much in your life. He loves you so much that he will come to where you are, but he loves you too much to leave you there. But he will walk along beside you to get you where you need to go. But you got to welcome him first. And if we are welcoming Jesus into our lives, then we ought to be welcoming those around us. And the problem becomes when we don't welcome those around us, then we may not be welcoming Jesus to begin with. Or we may be welcoming Jesus to a point. Say, Jesus, I will allow you into my life, into my heart, to this ceiling. This is the cap. This is the limit, Jesus. You can do this much. You can change this much in me, but you cannot change this, that, and the other thing. I've been doing this thing for 75 years. I'm not going to change it, Jesus. You can't touch it. That's me. And if this person wants to be with me, they got to fix their thing, and I'm going to stay this way forever. And we're limiting the access we're giving to Jesus. Essentially, in the house of our hearts, we're creating a dead spot for his connection, that he cannot reach that area. And we need to fix us, our sync up, so that when somebody begins to invade that dead spot and cause issues and cause problems, and we immediately think the problem is with them, but it's not, it's with us, and we miss out on what God intends because we're blocking God from that area of our life. And this happens in discussions, in conversations. Let's just take you and your family. Let's take you and your husband, you and your wife. Has there ever been a disconnect in communication? Ever? Nope, nobody. Just me. Only me. And part of it is because I'm a male, and there's things that I miss or things that I don't hear. And can I get an amen from the men? I mean, come on, for real. There may be, there you go, something that goes in your ear, and because it goes in your male ear, you interpret it a certain way. You got a filter about between your ear and your brain. It hits that filter, and it changes a little bit from what went in, and you don't quite get it. And it may cause an issue because you have interpreted the thing in the incorrect manner. And the problem then becomes, in my mind, well, she didn't tell me right. But the problem's not Katie. The problem's me. I didn't hear it right. The problem is the disconnect here. The problem is me. I've created that dead spot. I put up that filter. That's on me. Not on the one doing the communicating, that's on the one doing the hearing. And in our own hearts and in our own lives, in our own areas, we need to stop assuming the connection problem is with anyone except ourselves. That should be the first place we go. If there's a problem or an issue, the immediate place we go should not be, man, they are messed up. They are all kinds of, Jesus needs to get a hold of their lives and needs to fix everything they got going on. Needs to fix their tires and everything. They're just screwed up, man. Jesus got to take care of their whole mess. All the while we're messed up ourselves. We need to stop assuming the problem is somebody else and immediately begin to see, maybe it's me. Maybe it's me. I mean, it's like me in the garage on the elliptical trying to do the thing. And I went for months thinking it was the router's problem. Moving it all over, drilling holes so that I could run the line a different way, trying to, you know, man up and fix it and do this other thing. And none of that ever worked. It was all because it was my device that was the problem, not the router. Stop assuming that it's somebody else and immediately begin to think, wait a minute. Maybe it's my connection to Jesus and not that person's potential weakness. What I saw in the other person as a potential weakness or potential problem was really not theirs. It was mine. I had a misunderstanding of the grace of God. God offered me grace, but I'm not willing to offer any grace to that person, whoever it might be. Stop immediately assuming that the hashtag connection problem is with them. You see, with that capacity of grace that Jesus welcomes us, we need to be welcoming to others, having that capacity grace, because this is what it comes to. This is the big issue here, this last statement. Because with the capacity of grace, or with the amount of grace in your welcome, that is determined by the amount of Jesus in your life. How you welcome somebody else with the capacity of grace that you have put into your welcome, into your access, into your life, the amount of grace that you put there is determined, is characterized by the amount of Jesus you have in your life. And so if you put a cap on the amount of grace, on the amount of things you are willing to deal with, or as using Paul's word in verse 1, if you put a cap on the amount of things you are willing to endure in somebody else's weaknesses, then you've put a cap on the amount of Jesus you want in your heart. Jesus has saved you if you're a believer. He has, but he tells you he wants to fill you up, not just have a little bit, not just have a portion of you. He wants the whole shebang, and to do that, you need to grant him access. You need to cut down the dead spots of your heart and give him access to the whole thing. Because then he can take you to places you never thought possible. You can embrace the full grace that he has issuing forth from his own heart, pouring into you. He wants to overflow your life with that grace. But too often we limit it. We say, I don't want the whole thing. I'll just want what I'm comfortable with. I just want what fits into my schedule, what fits into my calendar. I just want that. And if anyone tries to jam something into my schedule, into my comfort zone, I'm going to flip on the airplane mode switch, and I'm just not even going to access it. That's a limit. I'm limiting what God can do. I'm putting a cap on how much Jesus I want. I will allow Jesus in my life up to where I'm comfortable with. But if he begins to go over and above that, then I'm done. It's over. You know, the Christians in the very first church in the book of Acts had the same issue. And that issue, though, was dealing with race, having Gentiles coming into the church that before that had just been Jewish Christians. And they said, in order to be with us Jewish Christians, you Gentiles have to follow all these rules. And they had this big old massive church business meeting. Apostle Peter gets up and speaks. John speaks. The Apostle Paul speaks. Jesus's brother James, who is the pastor of that church, gets up and speaks and says, none of that's right, man. All that they need is Jesus. They don't need the rules. They don't need those things. All you need in your life if you're a believer is Jesus. And they had that big meeting, and they issue a letter to all the churches. You need to let go of those rules and not do the rules. It's not about the rules. It's about Jesus. You need to welcome them, just as Paul says here. Endure their weaknesses. Welcome one another. Jesus welcomed you. Don't put a cap on how much grace Jesus can issue into your life, because you don't want to put a cap on that. So we must issue the same amount of grace to those around us. And so if you want to embrace that grace, you need to know Jesus, first of all. You need to believe that he came and died and rose from the dead. And then he will flood your life with grace. And you need to be welcoming to one another, not limiting the grace, but offering it freely, welcoming those around you into your circle, into your life with full access, not creating the dead spots in your heart, so that you can not only grow closer to Christ at the full capacity that he desires, but they can as well. So that those words he used at the beginning when he says, we who are strong should endure the weaknesses of those who are not strong. But when we limit the grace of Jesus, when we limit the grace in our welcome, when we limit the Jesus in our hearts, we are really not the strong. We are really the one with the exposed weaknesses, the not strong, as he says there. We have deluded ourselves into thinking we are strong, when in fact, we are the opposite. And in truth, if we were all honest with ourselves, we have an infinite amount of room to grow in Christ, and we need to be striving towards that purpose. But in so doing, we need to have just as much grace for those around us who are also trying to grow in Christ. Giving up whatever it might be that is limiting them, even if it's outside of my schedule and my comfort zone and what I like, so that they can grow, maybe potentially stronger than me, and do much more for Jesus than I can. They can be whatever amount of influencer that God designed for them to be, the Apostle Paul or a Billy Graham or something of that capacity. I was looking on social media this morning. Franklin Graham has been having a crusade over the weekend, and they're adding dates. I mean, they're pulling music guys off the road to come and lead their worship because so many people are coming to Christ. And maybe that person that you need to help grow in Christ is that very same type of person God has designed, but we need to let go of the limit we've placed and allow the grace to flow without bounds within our hearts to those around us, and not limit the Jesus in our own lives. So wherever you find yourself on the spectrum, if you need to know Jesus for the first time and embrace that grace right up front, or if you're over here and you've been a believer for years and you're strong in Christ, but you still have a dead spot walled off in your heart, it's time to let it go. Pull the walls down and reconnect. Turn your heart off of airplane mode and sink back up to what God has designed for you.